What's up, everyone? Welcome to our next word problem type video. We're going to be talking about arrays and area. As always, make sure you check to see if there are any downloads or resources that go along with this video. All right, let's get into it. So just like I stated in many of the other multiplication and division videos, I know that it seems weird that there are different word problem types, because when you're thinking about these two operations, you kind of feel like, well, it's just regular multiplication and division. There can't be more to that. But that's just not the case. There are several different forms of multiplication and division. And I make a video for each different type. In this video, we're going to just concentrate on arrays and area. Now, this unit probably seems pretty straightforward because it's arrays and area, but there's actually some complexity involved here, so I want us to address that. But before we actually get into that piece, let me just give you a little bit of a background first on the word problem types. Okay, so these are the three different components of multiplication. We have equal groups, obviously arrays and area, and then we have comparison. Now, these are actually broken down into even smaller sections. Here's the deal. We actually help kids fall into a trap when we say that multiplication is repeated groups. Yes, multiplication is repeated groups, but multiplication is more than that as well. Multiplication is comparisons, rates, arrays, ratios. So we cannot continue to say multiplication is just equal groups. Then when students are given a different format, it's hard for them to have a deep understanding for it. But we're gonna get into all these different types of multiplication in other videos, so make sure you check those out. So you'll notice that there's a different subsection in each of the word problem types. This example comes from Teaching Student-Centered Mathematics, the grades 3-5 book. This is the Vandewalle series. Now, if we take a look at arrays and areas, they're specifically in separate sections, and there's a reason for that. We're going to talk about that reason in just a second. Let's just go over one more thing before we get into that piece, and that is that there are three types of unknowns when we deal with word problems. We have unknown product, the unknown group size, and the unknown number of groups, right? So that's where your division comes into play, your inverse operations. Now, going back to why area and array are in different subsections of this word problem type, it's actually because area and arrays are not interchangeable. What they are, though, is symmetric. So I want to talk about what that means, that they're not interchangeable, but they are symmetric. Okay, so according to, and I hope I'm getting these name pronunciations correctly, according to Delano Moore, Mara Long, and Gojack, when factors in a problem do the same work, it's symmetric, right? Which is actually the opposite of equal group word problems. So in order for it to be symmetric, that means the two factors have the same unit or similar units, right? So if we're talking about square inches, and then the unit of the product is a new unit. What also makes it symmetric is that the factors are commutative, which, yes, that happens in multiplication. You have commutative property, right? But in symmetric word problems, the factors are commutative and they're interchangeable. So if they're swapped, no meaning is lost here. Now, asymmetric is the exact opposite. That means that the factors are not interchangeable. It means that if the factors were swapped, you would lose meaning. For example, like equal groups, you know, if you have three groups of four, that means something specific, right? But if you have four groups of three, that means something else specifically. So the factors are not interchangeable depending on the context. So those are asymmetric problems, but let's just go through an example. I want us to look at this word problem. This is adapted from the Mathematize It book. For grades 3-5, I want us to go through this math story, this word problem, and I want us to pause. I want us to take a second and pause, think about it, and decide if this is an array word problem or an equal groups word problem. So I'm putting you to work. All right, here's the word problem. Chantel wanted to arrange her toy trains On her bookshelf, she arranged them so that four trains were showing at the front and the trains made two rows on the bookshelf. So pause the video, take a second, just think about it. Which word problem type would this be considered? Okay, so I have a visual here of what the math story relayed, right? There's four trains showing in the front and there were two rows made. Because these items physically appear, like they're in an array form, right? You can see it in an array form. It doesn't necessarily mean it's an array. I want you to check this out. For starters, the factors are not interchangeable, right? We think that they might be, but they're not, because if we flipped it, the trains wouldn't even fit on the shelf, right? So this is actually an equal groups word problem that looks like an array. It has to be two groups of four in order for it to fit on the bookshelf. But now here's where things get a little bit complicated, and that's why I said like there's some complexity involved here. It depends on the context, right? Because if she had her toy trains like we just saw on the bookshelf, yeah, the factors wouldn't be interchangeable because it's like they can't float in air, right? If you were to change the context and say that she wanted to arrange her toy trains on a table, she could arrange it in either way, and then this would be considered an array. So the context that you're giving the students matters. Okay, I wanna dig a little deep into the definitions. I got some things to say about the definitions. So starting off with arrays. Arrays, you know, they're pretty much shown early, second grade-ish, starting with talking about rows and columns. So just simply meaning that a row times a column equals a cell, right? Now, area does involve arrays of squares that have been pushed together so that there's no like gaps or overlaps. Now, when we talk about area and its definition, I've always defined area as a unit of measure. So with this being said, students need to know terms like measuring, covering, area, square unit, plane figure, gap, overlap, square, you know, inches, feet, whatever your unit is. What I don't do and what I would encourage you not to do is to not define it as length times width. Now, that's not saying that teachers do define it as length times width, but we focus so much on the formula that students internalize area as only length times width. I have worked with, at this point, thousands of students, and when I speak to third graders and ask them what area means, I often get, oh, area means length times width. That is not the definition of area. And here's why this is an issue. When they have to find areas of other shapes, they're gonna be like, oh damn, we were just told it was length times width, and now that there's this other thing. So area is the measuring of covering, right? And in order to relay what area really is to students, we have to dig deep into our standards. Now, I know not all state standards are the same. I'm just gonna use this one for an example. Area should always be linked to measurement, no matter what state. It's a measurement link or domain or whatever you guys, you know, your district is calling it. But take a look at this example here. Look at how many times the standard says area of a rectangle. This is so important. Look at how many times areas of rectangles, an area of a rectangle, non-overlapping rectangles. This is important because when we talk about finding the area, we should be specific to say this is the way we find the area of a rectangle. We should not be saying this is the way to find area when we're using the formula length times width. And guess what? When we start changing our language and we start saying this is finding area of a rectangle, making sure we're saying that rectangle, this is going to open up some curiosity. This is going to lead to some curiosity in your classroom. The kids are going to be like, wait, that's just the area of a rectangle, but is there different ways to find area of different shapes? You want that inquisitive nature in your room. And we don't get questions like that from students when we make it very formulaic. So I want you to keep that in mind. What's cool about area is that it connects to an area model, which is a computational tool that we use. But this video is just about word problem types. We'll get into a different video on computation strategies. The reason why I bring that up is I think because we use area models as computation strategies, that's what kind of leads us to make things formulaic. We want to remove that. We want to remove that from our instruction. Okay, so let's dig into now some of these word problem types, some examples. Okay, but before getting started, I'm going to share a little pet peeve of mine. Now, technically, when we show array problems, all the problems have to do with freaking farmers, right? And their farmers and their garden. And here is my suggestion for this, right? We have to make things culturally relevant, period. I mean, that is just non-negotiable. If you're going to use problems like this, if you're going to use a curriculum problem that you have, at least make sure that you're using foods from other countries, right? Make it relatable to the children. So, for example, in this problem, I put cassava plants, right? Cassava, sambuca, that is what people eat. It may not be something you eat, but it's something that people eat. Everything cannot be about these farmers and their carrot and tomato gardens. So I really want us to use this opportunity to modify our textbook or curriculum resources in order to make it culturally relevant. When you ask students their favorite foods or what they like to eat or what they don't like to eat, whatever, you get a sense of what's happening, like what is their culture, and you can bring that in. We'll talk a little bit more about that later, but I just wanted to mention that piece. So we're talking about cassava plants in these examples. Okay, let's get into this first one. My garden has 4 rows and 5 cassava plants in each row. How many cassava plants are in my garden? So when we're looking at this word problem type, we know the number of rows that there are. We know the number of plants in each row. The unknown is going to be the total number of plants or items, right? So that is what the array would look like and the multiplication sentence for it. But this changes as you get into the next word problem type. So my garden has 20 cassava plants. There are 4 rows with the same number of plants in each row. How many cassava plants are in each row? So we have the total number of plants. We have the total number of rows, and students would need to figure out how many plants in each row. This is our division, right? But students can use the inverse operation of the missing factor in order to figure out the division equation, right? So if we're doing 20 divided by 4, students can use 4 times something to get them to 20. And the last word problem types involving arrays would be my garden has 20 cassava plants. There are 5 cassava plants in each row. How many rows are in my garden? Again, we know the total number of plants. Now we know the plants in each row, so it's flipped, and we have to figure out how many rows there are. So again, a division situation where you can use the inverse operation to figure out the amount. So these are the three different word problem types for arrays. They all involve a different unknown. Let's dig into area. So for area, I put this example. The length of my garden is 4 feet. The width is 5 feet. What is the area of my garden? So what's known is the dimensions. And then the unknown is basically the area, right? How many square units is this? Or how many square feet is this? Now, I lumped the next two word problem types together because they're pretty much the same, and I'll explain. If you pause and read these two word problem types, what's known in both of them is the total area. We know it's 20 square feet. And we also know one dimension. So we either know the length or we know the width. The unknown here is the other dimension. So even though this is called group size unknown and number of groups unknown, when it comes to area, what this really means is that we know one dimension, but we don't know the other dimension. All right, let's dig into some strategies on word problems. Now, there's a whole separate video on word problem strategies that you can check out. I'm always going to advocate for you to use sense-making strategies and not shortcuts. So no keywords. There's a separate video on keywords. Watch it. No keywords, no tricks, no shortcuts. You want them to make sense of what they're doing. So here are a few suggestions that you might want to incorporate when working with word problems. First up, you got to use math tools, period. You got to make it hands-on. We jump way too quick to equations. We jump way too quick to the pictorial representation. I just showed an example of that with area. We jump too quick to the formula. No matter what grade level, students need to manipulate what's going on in the story. When it comes to areas and arrays, our fallback is always draw a rectangle and figure it out from there. Students need these math tools in order to gain a deep understanding, a conceptual understanding of these word problem types. So I recommend hands-on tools even for fifth grade when students are finding area, but their area has fractional parts. Yeah, hands-on math tools need to be used there too. I also recommend with every single word problem type is that students create their own word problem. This honestly is a critical skill that students need. We have difficulty creating math stories and word problems. As adults, we have difficulties in creating them. Imagine how much easier it would be if we were given that opportunity as students to be creating our own math stories. The reason why I bring this up as a critical skill is that when students create their own math story, it actually gives them a deeper understanding of what the operation means. Not what the math story means, it gives them a deep understanding of the operation. So they have to think about, oh shoot, okay, this is a multiplication equation. Do I want to make this an array? Do I want to make this an area question? Do I want to make this an equal group question? Do I want to make this a comparison question? Students don't do that. So we need to give them the opportunity to do that. So very critical skill is creating your own word problems. Honestly, there's a lot of gray matter in their brain being used when they do this. So it's a win-win. Have them do that. Next up, which I also always mention, is that word problems have to be culturally relevant, right? So there's a couple of ways that we can make word problems culturally relevant. One is to use the student's environment, which they're in every day, school. Look around your school and use that as context, right, for your word problem types. So for example, this is a photo number talk, right? The website is there. And look, I mean, you can simply make multiplication word problems based off this one image. And this is something that's just lying around in schools. So you can for sure look online for photo images and situations, of course, but also just walk around your building, take a snapshot when you see something that's similar to either an array or area. Another way to make things culturally relevant is to use the student's community. Using the local community is the same as the students using the school to find arrays and areas, right? So this, for example, you can talk about rows and columns off of this image. What I really want to get at here with using community in school is that, like, we have to kind of move away from every array and, you know, every array problem being the farmer and planting his carrots and tomatoes. I know I mentioned this earlier, but we have to show kids math in their world. But great, they could be living in a town that is a farming town. That's great, but what about the rest of the world? We have to think about how we can give students the opportunity to see math in their world. So we want to utilize schools to talk about areas and array. We want to utilize the community. And we also want to utilize the world. Now, what can this look like if we're talking about areas and array, right? For, you know, and you're looking at the world. You can include a picture of a protest or, you know, people lined up in an array form. And then you can embed that social justice piece because you're talking about topics as well as talking about the math. Or if you want to look at area, all right, area doesn't always have to be a garden or finding area for your room. It could be maybe finding area, link it to something in social studies, right? It could be finding the area of land that was taken away from indigenous people. That's a social justice issue, right? All you need is a map, some grid paper, and you can have students find the area of land. Again, you open the students up to the world. Now, the reason why I bring this last piece up, the social justice piece and attaching and linking things to the world, is because if you teach in a classroom of primarily white students, you're not bringing diverse culture into those rooms. So you want to take the opportunities to use math from what's happening in the world, either current events or past events, but you want to bring in that culture. Students need to see math in their own personal world, like their surroundings, but they also need to see it, what it looks like outside their town bubble. So we have to ensure that with all these word problem types that we're making them culturally relevant. And that does mean that you have to modify some of your curriculum resources and your curriculum materials, because many curriculum materials and programs are made for the masses and they don't actually reach what your students are seeing day to day. All right, everyone, that's a wrap from me. We took a look at areas and array in this video. Please make sure you check out the other multiplication type videos in order to get a sense of the different word problem types there are. Thanks for watching, everyone.